brothers and sisters, we have red behind us because yesterday was confirmation here and nobody knows this one this morning. But it's a good reminder for us, the bishop, the great yesterday, confirmation is not a graduation. It's a launching into the world. Discover that we are all gifted, but we are gifted for the kingdom. It means that for those kids who made it yesterday, it means that for all of us who made it some time ago. Hunger is to be reminded of that call of in our life and the need, the great need that lie out there for the kingdom. For those times that we listen carefully to that call of God, we discern where God is calling us to be living stones in this world. Let's give thanks. But for those times that we have not, ask God's forgiveness, and ask that this liturgy may enliven in us the desire to live more fully for all of God in our life. I say, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
They presented these men to the apostles, who prayed and laid hands upon them.
disciples in Jerusalem increased greatly, even a large number of priests made their submission to the faith. The word of the Lord.
In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places.
Remember not that I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you also may be. Where I am going, you know the way. Father said to him, Master, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to me to the Father except through me. If you know me, then you also know my Father. From now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Master, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you for so long a time, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own. Father who dwells in me is doing his works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father is in me, or else believe because of the works themselves. Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever believes in me will do the works I do. Whoever does greater ones than these, and will do greater ones than these, because I am going to the Father. The Gospel of the Lord. I can preach 10 minutes without a note. I really wish I could read the Gospel of John without stumbling on it. I was preparing for this homily. It was the first reading, however, that grabbed me. There's a problem in the early community. As the numbers of disciples continued to grow, the Hellenists complained against the Hebrews because their widows were being neglected in the daily distribution. I was thinking maybe our Congress should read this particular section. There's a problem in the community. And the response is, well, that's your problems, not our problems. That's not how they do it. Nor do they say, there's not a problem. We don't see a problem. There's no blame, folks. There's no invasion of a problem. There's, okay, let's think outside the box. How do we solve this problem together? And they do it through people being called by God to a new ministry, a creative new ministry that will take care of the most vulnerable in both communities, the widows, the orphans. Now, 2,000 years later, we still have the diaconate, and men are called to it. And we have a member of our parish who 2 years ago, Pat Brown, became a deacon. And I run into Pat in the hospital visiting the sick. Pat and his wife for a good number of years have run our St. Francis Emergency Assistance Fund, which used to be St. Vincent de Paul. And what they do together as a couple is they help this community to serve the needs of the most vulnerable among us, those being evicted. Last year alone, they kept 25 families running out on the street. And it's a wonderful ministry. But our second reading reminds us that we are all a royal priesthood. We are all living stones from which God builds the kingdom. And we're all given with different gifts and talents, and we're called to utilize them together. When I think about my 12 years here and the many, many ways I have seen people feel the call of God and come forward, I think of Lauren here, who's in our school. Where does someone like that get the courage to stand up and proclaim the word so beautifully, if not by the word, call of God? I told her that she would give Bob some tips in terms of taking his game to the next level, because when she proclaims the word, it goes straight to my heart, which is so beautifully. God has given her that gift. Now she's worked on it. But she answered the call of God. I see Peter and Zuma out there, who I had in search when they were kids. They could have taken the retreat experience and said, well, I've got mine out of the book. They worked for years in the program, and now as adults, have each led two retreats. They heard the call of God and answered it as a call. And the stories are endless, but there is one story to me that is the most powerful, I think because it's had the greatest impact in this parish. And that's the story of Joan Conway. Joan has been in this parish about as long as I have, I think. Joan worked at the agriculture department for many years. She got a PhD. But felt the call to do something ministerially. And we had a food pantry back then, if you wanted to call it. It was a couple of shelves of expired Vienna sausages and cocktail onions and everything else that nobody wanted, and especially the people coming, and there weren't a whole lot of people coming. But Joan had a vision for how we could serve the needs of the people of our area. And then she went and she talked to people about what did people in our area who were in need like to eat? What was part of their cultural diet? Then she used her knowledge in nutrition to crack the menu. But Joan knew she couldn't do this ministry alone. So she called other people from this parish. The people heard the call of God through her. And slowly this pantry became built up. And then she reached out beyond the boundaries of this. She reached out to other parishes. She reached out to other churches, other denominations, like the Adelphi Friends who were visiting the other day in such faithful parts. She reached into other faith groups. We have a Buddhist community that serves faithfully the Landing Park Pantry that Joan founded after she founded this one. And every month there is a community that serves there. I think it's 30 bags of food. One of the key members of our administrative team of the food pantry is a member of that community, and I don't know where we would be without Vincent. He's automated the whole system. Joan nurtured people. And each year we saw the numbers grow. She would do fundraising, tapping into people's hearts, reminding people that these are our brothers and sisters. This is how we take care of this community. And then after 10 years, Joan decided that it was time to answer another call of God in her life, to work in a more spiritual area. In fact, she just gave a retreat last weekend to 25-30 Jesuit volunteers. It was a Franciscan retreat, but she didn't tell them. But I think the greatest testimony to Joan was the fact that when she stepped down, there were enough people that it felt empowered, that it felt so comfortable with the ministry, that they stepped up as a team. And the pantry didn't float. In fact, it served more people last year than ever before. That's what great leaders do. They create something, they think outside the box, they get involved in the community and outside the community, and then they move on to the next call in our life, because God has never done with us. God uses what came before to help us to go forward. Each and every one of us is called by God. Now some are called to be lectors, or Eucharistic ministers, but the vast majority of us are called to build the kingdom out there, to make this world a better place. Probably the most concrete way I can think about it. And it requires us discerning where that call of God in our life is. I started the Ignatian Spiritual Exercises. I got a book 2 years ago. I found it under my bed. I had read two chapters, and apparently it had fallen on the floor, and then I kicked it under the bed, and it wasn't until I lost my iPhone and I'm looking for it that I found this book. Well, I'm on chapter 3. And chapter 3 talks about what a retreat is. I always used to think of a retreat as you go out and get away from the problem. Well, that's a piece of it, although this retreat is for a retreat in daily life, so you don't get too far for too long. But it's to answer the call of God in your life. It's to provide a space where God talks to you, not where we babble like God, but where God speaks to us about what God wants for and from our life to build the kingdom. And we've all been given gifts and talents. And in community, we have examples of people like John that we hold up from time to time to show us what is possible, not from our own efforts, but what happens when we let God reside in us and do great things beyond our imagination. When I was part of the Cardinals Administrative Board, and we had a 75th anniversary of the Archdiocese. And each pastor was asked to nominate one person who has been a powerful force in the building of the kingdom in their community, and marshaling the resources of their community, to make this world a better place. The decision took me all of 3 seconds to nominate Joan, and I'm very happy to say that I would like Joan to come forward and receive the 75th anniversary award from the Archdiocese.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Let us go in peace, beloved, and serve our God.